I will declare with my mouth, yes, Lord. Come on, mama, sepora bondas de kida. Yeah. Oh, hallelujah. I will sing like never before. Oh, my soul. Worship. Yeah. The name above every name. The name of Jesus. Blessed is your name. The name above every name. Kings bow to that name. Sickness and disease bows to that name. I worship your holy name. Yes, I worship your holy. Can you sing it one more time? Yes, I worship your holy name. One more time. Yes, I worship your holy name. Wow. Hallelujah. Oh, my goodness. Well, I have to ask, is there anyone here tonight? We've been worshiping the Lord. And as you've been worshiping Him and magnifying Him, you came in with pain in your body, but that pain is gone. Is there anyone like that? You came in with pain, but as you've been worshiping, the pain's gone. Where was the pain, sir? I can't. It's in his back. It's gone. Come on, come on. Anyone else? Come on, anyone else? Came in with pain. Where was the pain? In your stomach, and it's gone. Isn't that awesome? Come on, everything you need. Everything you need is found in his presence. Hallelujah. Well, hug the person next to you. Say, I'm so glad you're here. And it wouldn't be near as much fun without you. Oh, you guys are awesome. You okay? I know it's tough. Frustrating when you can't hear. Oh, my goodness. Hallelujah. No, I'm good, man. I love it. I tell you, so much word right here in front of me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, my gosh. Oh, my goodness. That's what he says over you. Oh, my goodness. I've come to shower you with my goodness. Bless the Lord, bless the Lord. In this room, your presence can be found as the idols of our soul come crashing down. Hearts are opened by your holy wind as the praises of God's people ascend. So we kneel in honor of you, Lord. as we see you high and lifted up. As your train fills the temple and the cloud moves in, and the glory of the Lord is revealed, the cloud of your glory fills this place. The glow of your presence is on each face. We enter in by the sacrifice of praise. With clean hands and a heart that's pure, we say, Lord, your presence is all that we embrace. The cloud of your glory fills this place. The cloud of your glory, the Holy of Holies, the cloud of your glory fills this place. The cloud of your glory, the Holy of Holies, the cloud of your glory this place, this place. Lord, we're so honored that you would meet us here. We don't take nights like this for granted. We're so grateful that you meet us here. But Lord, you gave us the comfort to God, the Holy Ghost, that you would come and dwell with us here, filling every part of our life, every aspect of our life. We're so grateful. We're so grateful.
Come on.
holy, 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 Lord God, almighty, early in the morning, my song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 so merciful and mighty, my God in three sing it with me one time. Holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, early in the our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. God in three persons. God in three one more time. God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Hallelujah. Do you have one more shout in you tonight? Come on. Hallelujah. Worthy. 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 My God, you're worthy. So worthy. Receive our praise. Receive our praise. Receive our praise, oh God. We worship you. 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 Oh God. Hallelujah. I just want to, if you have a piece of paper and you'd like to write just down a couple of scriptures. This morning we talked about the whys of worship. He says, oh, that we would have ears to hear. And I don't know why he picked me. I don't know why he picked me. But I can tell you from the time I was a little boy, I could hear the sound of heaven. And so when I hear somebody sing, I just want to hear the sound of heaven. When I go to a church, I want to hear the sound of heaven. Because you see, people can sing a song and they can do all the right notes. They can say all the right words. They can make all the right moves. But it's empty. I can remember when my dad was preaching and I was a little boy and we didn't have all the channels and, you know, all that mess. We'd get in the car at night after church and he would drive. And my dad would sit in the car and he and mom would sing. That was their way of whatever was going on, whatever the circumstances were. We'd go on vacation and as we began to grow up, they would put in us the melodies and the harmonies. No one in our family played, so we sang a cappella. And then when I was 12, 13, I guess someone heard us singing in the car somewhere. And they asked us to do a couple of songs for the electrical co-op, some crazy meeting for public. Mom had a lady come over and we sang a couple of songs. Age 16, my dad said, we're going to do a revival meeting in Big Spring, Texas. And he said, we're going to learn a song every day and we're going to sing it. So the first song we learned was, Let Me Touch Him. Let me touch Jesus. Let me touch him as he passes by. It's the first one we learned. Second one we learned. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. First two songs we learned as our family. Something wonderful happened. And now I know he touched me and made me whole. Third song. Until then, my heart will go on singing. Until then, with joy, I'll carry on. You see, Rodney didn't teach us about the joy. We knew about it. We just stepped over into it. Until the day mine eyes behold that city. until the day God calls me home. Remember that one? And then the fourth one we learned was, without him, I could do nothing. Without him, I'd surely fail. Without him, I would be drifting like a ship without a sail. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Do you know him today? Please don't turn him away, oh Jesus, my Jesus. Without him, how lost I would be.
That was Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Then Friday night we did a concert of the four songs we had learned. Age 18, my mom and my dad, we were doing a revival in A-Leaf, Texas, First Baptist Church. You see, I grew up with asthma. I was an asthmatic. I took all the medications you take, and I had the asthmatic swollen chest. One of the nights I couldn't sing, I was under an oxygen tent on Wednesday night, staying in somebody's home. One of the very few times in my life I couldn't sing. About 10:30, 11 o'clock, my dad walked in the room with the pastor of the church. And he said, son, you awake? And I said, yeah. He said, the pastor wants to anoint you with oil and pray for you to be healed. He said, can we do that? He said, do you believe God can do that? I said, Daddy, you know I do. Because there were times as we ministered and sang Baptist churches. I remember a little young woman walked up and she had a 3 or 4 day old baby and she's weeping. Sunday morning, Andrews, Texas, First Baptist Church. She walks up to my dad in the invitation. She just basically hands my daddy her baby and she says, my baby's dying. She said, they tell us that without a miracle, my baby's going to die. She's got a blood disorder, and babies don't live very long with this disorder. My daddy said, does anybody have any oil? Pastor, you have any oil? He went, we don't have any oil. Can somebody get me some oil? And one of the men of the church went across to 7-Eleven. True story. Brought back some 3-in-1 oil. He didn't know what kind of oil to buy. He brought back some 3-in-1 oil, machine oil for your soul machine. And so my dad, he didn't even look twice. He just squirted it in his hand. Just laid his hand on the baby's head. He said, Lord, you created this little one. Lord, you're the healer. We left town. 5 or 6, 7 days later, I don't remember the time frame. It's way too long ago. But I remember the call. Well, hello, pastor. How you doing? It was the pastor from the church. He said, you remember that baby you prayed for last week? A few weeks ago, whatever it was. Dad said, yeah, I remember. He said, they can't find anything wrong with that baby. Another little oil-filled town, Big Lake, Texas. We're there, and there's probably 700-800 people. It's an area-wide crusade. Baptists, Methodists, Presbyterian, Catholics, Pentecostals. And if you've ever been in West Texas, when the wind begins to blow, I mean, rocks are flying, and I mean, there's this brown haze you can see for miles. Ranches trade places. And I mean, we're in this fair barn, and the louvers on the top of that metal building are just, as long as we had the sound cranked up, everything was fine. But when Dad got ready to preach, you couldn't hear anything. I never will forget, he walks up to the front, and he goes, "Well, folks," he said, "Lord brought us here to Big Lake, but," he said, "you know," he said, "I don't think I can preach above this noise." He said, "So I tell you what we're going to do." He said, "We're going to pray and ask God to stop the wind." And he said, "If he stops the wind, we can move forward." He said, "If he doesn't stop the wind," then he said, "we're going to pray. We're going to go home. We'll be back tomorrow." I look at my brother and I go, "No, he didn't. He's going to pray for God to stop the wind. He's going to embarrass us and embarrass everybody here and embarrass himself. And we're fixing to go home." I never will forget it. My dad, he just stands there, and he didn't pray some heavy-duty prayer. He said, "Now, Lord, this is your meeting. You brought us here, and if you want us to continue on tonight, you're going to have to stop the wind. So, Lord, tonight we just simply ask you. You tell us that the winds and the seas obey you. So, Lord, would you please stop the wind?" And I promise you, it was like you took a book, and you slapped it closed, and it went deathly quiet. Now, if you know anything about a windstorm, it does not work like that. It takes days for it to wind down. And that 700-800 people began to look around at each other. And I looked at my brother, and I went, "Oh, my goodness." And then my dad does what any great evangelist does. He said, "I want every head bowed and every eye closed." And he gave the invitation. And as you would expect, the altars were filled. They were. It was amazing. It was amazing. So when my dad, well, let me finish that story. We start our church in Austin, Texas in 2001. This is 20 years later. I had 1 4x8 wooden plywood sheet that had City Worship Center, Pastors Joe and Becky Cruse on it. That's what I had. And I look back toward the back of the congregation in the middle of the service, and there sat an elderly couple in the back. He's probably 78, 80 years of age. After the service is over, I walk back to him and I said, "Hi, my name is Joe Cruse." I said, "Welcome to City Worship Center." And he kind of tilted his head. He said, "You're part of that Cruse family that came to Big Lake, Texas?" I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "You know the time when God stopped the wind?" I said, "Yes, sir, I'm the oldest son." He said, "I was there in that meeting." He said, "Did you know," he said, "we gather at the Dairy Queen every Friday morning for coffee. There's a bunch of us that gather together. That's where we have our coffee and talk to each other." He said, "Son, I want to tell you." He said, "They still talk today about the time God stopped the wind in Big Lake, Texas." So when my dad walked in my room and said, "Son, do you believe God can heal you?" I said, "Daddy, you know I know he can." He said, "We want to pray for you." And so I just laid there and had this sheet over me, and they were pumping all kinds of stuff in there to just help me breathe. He laid his hands on me and he said, "Lord, you created this man for a purpose. Lord, he can't sing with the lungs that he has. Lord, we need a miracle." So, Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. I didn't feel any different. They left the room, and I went to sleep. But when I woke up the next morning, my lungs were totally clear, and I have never had an asthma attack since. I know your pastor loves to hunt. I love to hunt. But in Austin, we're surrounded with cedar. And it's one of the worst places in the world for allergies. Now, everybody's going for allergy shots and everything else, and I'm just sitting there going. When I go hunting, I take me a big old piece of that cedar, and I strip it off, and I rub my camouflage on it. And I sit down underneath the tree, and I'm enjoying it. Sounds like somebody's closet, you know. It's beautiful. Our family traveled till 1985. In October of 1985, through a series of events I will not go into, we all received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And then our circle of denominational friends didn't want anything to do with us, and they called us Cruse-o-matics. Put us in the national paper with our hands lifted and people with their hands lifted, and said, do you want this in your church? Then 1989, I went to Rockwall, Texas. 1994, a crazy South African came to my church. And these songs that we sang for you tonight and this morning, The Cloud of Your Glory, The Secret Place, God had given us those songs about 9 months before he came. And so one morning when he was ministering on the glory, he walked in front of me, and I have no idea why I did it. 3,500 people are there. And for whatever crazy reason, I looked up in those crazy eyes and I said, I have a song. And he looked down at me and he said, come sing it. And the song I just sang for you, The Cloud of Your Glory. And then he began to minister to people. He never preached that day. But that night he came back. And he had Molly Kelly with him, and a whole bunch of their team was there. And he said, Molly, I want you to come and sing. And he told her what to sing, and he went to hand her the microphone. And the moment she grabbed the microphone, she hit the floor. Never sang a note. And then he called somebody else, and he just reached out to hand them the microphone. And the moment they grabbed the microphone, poof, they hit the floor. And then he looked at me. Now, I had never fallen out under the power of the Holy Spirit before. I'm looking at this going, oh, my goodness. He said, come here. Come here. And I walked up those, I think there were 13 steps to get to the top. And when I got there, he grinned at me. The next thing I remember, 2.5 hours later, I'm looking at the roof. And I'd had the most incredible set of dreams, the most incredible encounter with a person of the Holy Spirit I'd ever had in my life. But in that journey with Pastor, the Lord had dropped in our heart a school. Because I hear the sound of heaven in people's voice. I know when heaven is on them. And the Lord said, I want you to put in the next generation what I put in you. And while ago, I was so overcome because I think, God, why do you pick me? Why did you pick me? Because I know I'm not the greatest singer. I listen to people like Michael English and Israel Houghton, and I hear these massive voices that have all the runs and ranges and all this, and I go, God, pick them. He says, no. He said, you know the sound of heaven. That's why I picked you. When I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, October the 30th, 1985, the Lord gave me a scripture in 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 20. When Elisha the prophet said, bring me a new cruse. C-R-U-S-E. And I looked at that and I said, oh my. My name is in the Bible. Because you see, when I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, there was a pastor who looked at our family and he said, your ministry as you know it is dead. It stinks. It needs to be buried. And I didn't understand what all that meant because I didn't understand words. I didn't know what words meant. I didn't know the power of a word, a prophetic word. But in the midst of that word that he gave us, he said, your ministry as you know it is dead. Little did we know that the denomination that we did all of their massive conferences and everything were going to turn their back on us because of the person of the Holy Spirit. But as I was riding on our bus back to Tyler, Texas, the Lord showed me in 2 Kings chapter 2, in verse 20, He said, "Bring me a new cruse and fill it full of salt." And then He took that salt and He began to pour it in a river that was contaminated, that was dead. And then He began to prophesy over that dead river. He said, "Not another day shall this be barren or dead, but from this day forward it shall live. And so shall it be to this day." And I grabbed my wife, who was laying next to me in that bunk, and I said, "Look at this." I said, "God is remaking us." And here's what I heard the Lord say. From this day forward, every time you open your mouth, He said, "I'm going to fill it with life." So in the midst of all of the transition of moving away from being a concert ministry, God took us back to the local church, and He began to prepare us for what we do today. He said, "I want this released in my church." We were the first ones to build a band and began to establish that type of worship, moving it to what they call contemporary worship today. Well over 20, 25 years ago. And to see the release of heaven in the church, that's our greatest joy. You cannot do what we've done tonight in many places. They're few and far between. Most people just worship their worship. Look at our band. Look at our lights. Look at our building. They worship their worship, but they don't worship Him. And so I shared that with you tonight because I've got a message, and I've got scriptures, and till Jesus comes, I've got stuff. You want to talk about worship? I'll keep you here forever. But in John chapter 4, verses 23 and 24, the hour cometh, and it is here now, when the true, genuine worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such a people. His eyes roam to and fro. He's listening for the sound of heaven in your voice. It's what He wants to hear. He doesn't need an empty song. He made the song. He's looking for a generation that will worship Him in spirit and truth. When I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I received the missing key that would unlock my heart and the sound of heaven on my life. That's what happened. You know why your pastor stirs the song of the Lord in the young men and women and in this house? Is because it's the key that unlocks your heart. It's the sound of heaven. You see, God is spirit. And those who worship Him, they must worship Him by the Spirit. John 14:7 says this, 14:17 says, because the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. He's the one who leads us to Jesus. Without the Spirit of God, you can't even get saved. Come on. You see, the Spirit leads us to the truth. Jesus is the truth, the life, and the way. Why do I share this? Because, just like I said, our worship, it's holy. Why is it holy? Because it's about Him. It's not about you. It's not about you. Our worship, it's not about how I feel. If you knew the number of times that I had to put my feet on a platform and I didn't feel like it. All hell had broken loose. Stuff was going on just like it goes on in your life. But I knew. I knew the truth. And I knew that if I released the truth, I changed the atmosphere, that my feelings would change. You see, in America today, most of our music is very soulish. It's very soulish. You can stand and sing all the right words, and you can do all the moves, and you can move people. But Paul there in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 spoke of holy emotions. You see, worship is holy. And God is all about stirring those holy emotions in you. We are people of emotion. You can go down here to the cinema just up the street here and watch a movie. And I'm not a movie maker, but you are. And the whole key is to take people in an hour or an hour and a half through every emotional gamut. That's their job. But our Heavenly Father is all about stirring in us those holy emotions. But it's about who He is. Can it be emotional? Yeah, but emotions can be empty. But you see, when we come and we worship in the reality of who He is, then we can step into the truth of who He is. Empty worship is devoid of power and truth. One thing my dad knew how to do was he knew how to pick a song. The first four songs he picked, he knew what he was picking. When I come into church, I'm listening for what songs are being sung, because those songs should be carrying you somewhere. No reality, no power. Most people come and they leave the same way they came, because they have no reality of what they're singing about. Philippians chapter 3 and verse 3 says, "We are the circumcision which worship God in spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus and have no confidence in the flesh." So whenever I stand and I have no confidence in my flesh, because I know there's so many more out there that can move people. Just, they're amazing. But when I stand and I begin to worship, you disappear. You're not even here, because you're not my audience. He's my audience. That's how I can stand. I break all the rules. You're supposed to open your eyes and make eye contact with every person. And I try. But sometimes you disappear. And He's the only one I see. Because what I love is the Spirit. He's the one who enables me to worship. He is the enabler. I can't even say Jesus is Lord without the Spirit. Can't do it. John chapter 6 and verse 44. No one can come to Jesus but by the Spirit. 1 John 2:20 says, "Without the push, the impulse," this is the Amplified, "the unction of the Holy Spirit, worship is done in the flesh." I have a little acronym for push. Praise until something happens. That's what I love about this man. He may sing the same song 30 minutes, but he knows there's coming a push. There's coming a release of heaven through that song. So he just waits. And then when it comes, the volume comes, the dance comes, the clap comes. He goes crazy. Why? He knows the push. And last of all, to worship him is to acknowledge his presence. Psalm 63, O God, earnestly I seek you. My inner self, it thirsts for you. Psalm 51:11, cast me not away from your presence. Psalm 100 and verse 2, come before his presence with singing. Psalm 66:3, say to God, how awesome and fearfully glorious are your works. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16. May he grant you out of the rich treasury of his glory to be strengthened and reinforced by the person of the Holy Ghost. The moment we step over into the glory realms of God, then anything you need is at your disposal. I told a story. I got one more. To worship in spirit and truth is to have the intimate relationship you've always longed for. His presence is here. Jesus, you're here. He declared it over and over. He's here. But what he wants is he wants you to step into that intimacy with him. Because he's done everything he can do. Ephesians 17 through 21, may Christ, through your faith, actually dwell, settle down, abide, make his permanent home in your heart. That's what worship does, is it stirs your faith to receive him and everything that he is. It's not to visit God, but it's to dwell with him. He wants to be your abiding place. To walk, to talk, to move, to have our being in him. And I'm just going to tell you, you may think this is crazy, but it even comes down to buying tickets. You can try and make things move and shift and do whatever, but it comes down to an unction. You have to do it this way. And if you can't get a peace about something, you just go, I'll do it tomorrow. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because sometimes we have had disagreements over the stupidest stuff. Buying tickets or stuff like that. And finally, we've got to the point where if we can't come into agreement about something, we just back away. Why? Because this intimacy in this realm, this cloud, this glory is worth more than anything else. There truly is a place where you can abide and live. And if nothing else, I want you to learn to hear the sound of heaven and let it permeate every aspect of your house and life. Be careful what music you pick, what music you play. There's a lot of great music out there, but there's a lot of anointed music out there that will change the atmosphere of your house. Learn to discern the sound of heaven. If you don't get anything else out of today, learn to discern the sound of heaven, the move of God, the move of his spirit. That when he shows up, We make room for Him so that He can lead us and guide us into all truth. I better do this because I'm about to forget. I've forgotten it about three times and the Lord just brought it back to me. Would you allow us to receive an offering for Worship Works Ministries International? Would you allow us to do that? And then we will minister to people. There's never a good time to take an offering. Places like this and atmosphere like this. I'm telling you, I'd just soon get on my face and just forget it. But we live in a real world, and there are needs. To let you know what Becky and I are doing, for the last 2.5 years, we have been working on getting our music college online. We kept hitting walls here and there. But the 1st of December, we made a covenant with the Lord that we were not going to allow the enemy to stay our hand any longer. And we said, Lord, we're going to be home. We're going to ask you to take care of us, provide for us, until this school launches January the 12th. And through an awesome move of heaven, our Heavenly Father provided everything that we needed, even new equipment to record the classes. In January the 12th, Cruse Institute Online came fully online around the world. And God gave us instructors to get it all done. They're from New York, they're from Australia, they're from Georgia, they're from Florida, they're from right here in California. Brother Josh is one of our instructors, my wife and myself. We have students from Thailand, from Brazil, from Africa, and all over the United States. And we're so excited. But in the process of walking through that, God has also brought people like yourself to help us do what He's called us to do. We have been able to drop the cost of the school and the classes from right at, for a whole year, about $7,000, to where now we can put the whole school and a young man or woman can go through the whole program for a whole year for less than $2,500. Our goal is to not cost anyone anything. Have you heard of Khan Academy? Anyone hear of Khan Academy? Khan Academy is a free online school for young men and women for the maths and sciences and however you say all that stuff. Microsoft got behind them, and they totally fund that whole program. Doesn't cost a kid a dime to go to that school. That's our goal. Right now, it costs us about $40,000 per semester. The last year I had the school in Austin, it cost me $1.1 million to fund our music college, the campus. So I have gone from $1.1 million to $80,000. All I'm asking you to do tonight is sow into what God's doing. What we're doing right now is every dime that comes in for the school goes straight to our instructors. We don't take one dime of it. I want to take care of my instructors. I want them to be blessed because they are taking this journey with us. We are leaving in the next 3 to 4 weeks to be in Thailand again, go to the Philippines, back home. Then we go to Africa, 2 or 3 places there. Then we come back to the States. Then we go back to Brazil. When we were here last year at this same time, you sowed a supernatural seed into Worship Works Ministries, and it took us to Bujumbura, Africa. Burundi, Africa, which is Bujumbura, Burundi, the capital city. There were over 11,000 people in every meeting. I can't tell you how many people were saved, but that's what your seed did last year, is it carried us to Bujumbura. And so tonight, I'm just going to give you an opportunity to sow seed. The church has envelopes. We have envelopes. Whatever you need to sow that seed. Do you want them to give it to the church, and you're going to give me one? So just make it out to Abiding Place. And if you need an envelope to sow supernatural seed with, debit or credit, we don't want you to give into debt. But if you'd like to sow a seed and you don't have the cash, if you need an envelope, just lift your hand, and one of these men or women will give you one. Take just a moment. Keep your hands up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you, man, I'm just been having a hard time just functioning. So I hope what I've shared makes sense. Hope it makes sense. Because what I want to do now is I just want to pray for people. I just want to lay hands on people. Pastor's going to help me. He doesn't know it yet, but he's going to help me. I need some help. Maybe you're here tonight and it's been hard to worship. Because of things that are happening, it's been hard to worship. It's like the enemy stole your song. He stole your joy. There's some of you here tonight, you could sow a supernatural seed, and you could take care of a whole semester. Maybe you're here tonight, and a dollar bill is sowing supernatural seed for you. It's not about the amount. It's about the heart. The Lord sees your heart. I'm going to pray that He brings it back to you. Pressed down, shaken together, running over. Shall men get back into your bosom? That this will be a supernatural week of supernatural harvest on your seed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Maybe you're here tonight and you have a creative idea that you've been stirring, that's been stirring in your spirit. I hear the Lord say it's a new season. It's time to launch out, prepare the ground for that new business. One of the things the Lord told us last year, He said, you can look at the ground, you can look, and you can talk about a new season, but until you allow me to prepare your heart to receive it, nothing will change. Time will just pass by. So we began to just pray, say, Lord, what do you want us to do? We began to pray and seek His face. And then we heard the Lord say, 1st of December, just plant. Trust me. Get it online. Don't look at the money. Don't look at anything. Just do what I tell you, what I've told you to do, and I'll meet you. And we saw the hand of God move. Maybe that's where you are today. God's been speaking to you, and He dropped something in your spirit, and you look at all the circumstances and go, Lord, it's not going to happen. It's not going to. Lord says, no, 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 no. Come on, it's time to trust me. Take a step of faith. And so we're just going to pray for people tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for every person in this room. Lord, we recognize that as they sow seed tonight, this represents the labor of their hands, their livelihood. And Lord, we believe in seed time and harvest. And so, Lord, tonight as they sow seed into Worship Works Ministries, Lord, we believe we're good ground. And Lord, as they sow seed, they're going to help us carry the sound of heaven around the world. That's what they're doing, helping us carry that sound of heaven to the next generation. And so, Lord, we thank you and we thank them ahead of time for this supernatural seed. Lord, you know our needs. We totally trust you. And Lord, we thank you that every need is met. Lord, bring these finances back to them. Lord, they sow into a supernatural heavenly bank account where moth and dust cannot corrupt and steal, and thieves cannot steal. But Lord, you reward us on this planet, on this earth. Not just in heaven, you reward us on the earth. Shall men get back into our bosom? Lord, I pray that every dream that they have be fulfilled. It's my heart's cry. Bring it back to them, not only in money, but that which money cannot buy. Maybe they're believing God for a family member, a new home, or whatever. Lord, we can't buy one drop of the anointing, but we can sow under the anointing, under the unction of the Holy Ghost. And so, Lord, we thank you. We bless this seed tonight. We bless every person. And all God's people said, amen. Hallelujah.